Good evening. How you guys doing? I guess we can get started now. We gave about 15 minutes, hoping we get more people, so we'll just get started. My name is Yusuf Awad. I'm the Chief Financial Officer, and I have with me David Wine, my Deputy CFO. And I have Sherry Lewis here. She's Senior Director of Accounting. And our goal today is really to give you an overview of the district finances and share with you some of the information we have about the district. And hopefully we can answer some of your questions. We'll try to make it as interactive as possible. That's our goal today. So I'm gonna get started and then we'll go through the agenda and I'll walk you through what we're gonna discuss today. So we're gonna do some introduction. We'll cover the school funding in Oregon. Is that clear? Okay, good. We're gonna talk about where we get our money and where we spend our money. Then we're gonna talk about some example of individual schools and how we fund them using our formula, equity formula, etc. Then we'll open for questions and answers. As you see in our very first slide, this is just a little bit of intro about the district. We have, the district was founded in 1851. I believe it's the oldest school district in Oregon. We have about 48,000 kids in the district with over 78 school sites. In addition to that, we have about 9 million square feet. That's the square footage we cover in our building across the boundary of the district. That's a little bit just of info about the district. In the next slide, I want to kind of show you trend in terms of where we are with ADM. Or ADM is average daily membership. That's the enrollment of our students. It's calculated by the state. We get our kids over the enrollment over the year, the school year, and it get allocated a number. That's what the ADM is. It's a little bit different than the number of kids in the district. I want to make sure that I highlight that difference. So as you see, the good news is that we are on the rise. Our enrollment is growing year after year for the last 5 years. In the next slide, what I wanted to show you here is the total funding that we get from the formula and the state school funding that we get from the state. And my goal is to show you this slide along with the slide before it. As you see, the growth in the ADM, it's the steep is a little bit higher. However, when you look at the funding, it's a little bit less. And the point there is we're not necessarily getting the amount of money per student based on our growth. So we may be getting a lot less proportionally in terms of funding than we get, than we grow in number of kids in the district. In this slide, this is, if you look at this slide, this is the state of Oregon, the school funding in Oregon. And this is an adjusted number, dollar amount per student, adjusted for inflation. And if you look at the number where we are today, it's less than what we had in probably 1991 or about 20 years ago. The point of this is we're not necessarily getting funding, not even on the level of about 20 years ago, which is really, if you think about it, if you earning money, the same amount of money you got 20 years ago, you probably wouldn't make a living. So that's the kind of reality we live in the state of Oregon. The other thing I want to point out, since 1991, we had a shift in funding. Our funding used to be almost completely from local sources, from local taxes. Since 1991 and Measure 5, that shifted the funding from the local taxpayer to the state. So now we currently get about 38% roughly of our resources from local taxpayer. So at this point, I'm gonna turn it to David and he'll go over where we get our money and how we get our allocation. Thank you.
Thank you, Yusuf. So you can see fairly simple description here of where do we get our money from. 3/4 of the money we get each year is through the state school fund. and the remaining 25% I'll talk about, the other quarter I'll talk about in just a minute. So the state school fund money comes in two ways. There's the permanent rate property taxes that we collect locally, and then there's the state school fund grant. And you can see in the adopted budget for this year, those two funding sources combined 74% of our revenue, 74% of our money, so three quarters. And if you look back over the last couple of years, it's been plus or minus around three quarters. 11% of our money, actually 15% of our money, is other local property taxes, which we actually get to keep here and don't share with the rest of the state. And then we have a beginning fund balance of money carried over from the prior year, and then less than 5% is other sources. Rental on properties, fees we charge for things, city arts income tax, and other miscellaneous sources like that. So just a quick word about property taxes. So this is a photograph of somebody's property tax statement with my name whited out. And I wanted to show you four things on here because they're relevant when we talk about property taxes. There are four things that come up all the time. So the first one is assessed value, which is those two numbers down there. And that's the number on which property tax rates are assessed. So if we tax somebody at $1 a thousand and the assessed value is $295,000, then they're going to get assessed for $295 in property taxes. The second number is the rateable market value, which is that higher number. And that leads into all kinds of complicated questions about compression and things like that that we probably won't go into today. But when you hear people talk about property taxes, those two values, assessed value and market value, are the two numbers that people talk about. And then over there on the right-hand side, you'll see there are two highlighted numbers for Portland Public Schools. The top one, the larger number, is that permanent rate property tax. That's the money that's part of the state school fund calculation. And the number below it, the smaller number, is the local option. So the state, that three quarters of our revenue that I talked about, is allocated by the state using a funding formula. And you heard Yusuf talk about ADM, the student membership. That funding formula is based on the number of students. There are some adjustments for various factors, but it's primarily driven by number of students. So the state calculates how much money we are due. And then that's broken down into what we collect through the local permanent rate property taxes, which was the larger of those two numbers you saw on the previous slide. And then that's topped up by the state school fund grant. So the state sends money to us to get us to that funding formula level. You heard Yusuf mention Measure 5, 1991, completely transformed the way that schools are funded in this state. Part of what happened as part of those reforms was equalizing funding across school districts across the state, so more affluent districts like Portland help support less affluent districts. And one of the ways that works is through this funding formula. So the amount is calculated based on how much money we're supposed to get, and then if our, and then the grant is based on the our estimate of local property tax revenue. If the amount of our local permanent rate property tax revenue goes up, then the amount of the state grant goes down to balance that out. So the important thing about those permanent rate taxes is they're part of the formula. We don't get to keep an increase in those. That contrasts with the local option levy. The local option levy, which was the smaller of those two numbers highlighted on that property tax statement, that money stays with PPS. It's ours to keep. If it goes up, we benefit fully from that increase. And we've had a local option for a number of years now. That has really helped us weather some of the cuts. It's helped mitigate cuts in state funding. You remember the slide that Yusuf showed you with the inflation-adjusted student funding that was going down over time? Our local option, thanks to the generosity and the support of Portland Public Schools voters, has helped mitigate the impact of that reduction in state funding. So the levy, the local option levy money doesn't go to the state, and it's not spread across other districts. So I'm going to turn it over to Sheree. Sheree's going to talk about some of the other ways in which we get money for schools, and then I'll come back and talk about how we allocate staffing. Sheree?
Thank you, David. Are you all excited now? You get to talk about money, and it's the most exciting thing in the world. Okay, some of the other ways that we think about how we get money, and I won't put my behind in the front of that, is federal money. Federal money is extremely complicated in this district because we have, on an average, about 150 to 250 grants. This district, at any one given time, has about $68 million in federal funding. But as we look at it, when you think about $60 to $70 million in federal funding, the major sources of those funding break out into about four major areas. Title I happens to do with the schools that are poverty, that are, like we think of the focus schools, we give those to money to those, and it's allocated by the number of students in that school, and the federal government gives us an allocation based on poverty and census in the school. Over the last couple years, that number has gone down because the federal government has changed how they give that money. Years ago, it was based on just census. Now it's based off census and poverty. Therefore, we've lost a little bit in money because the city of Portland and the Multnomah County doesn't have as high a poverty rate as the rest of the country. So we lose a little bit of money there, but we have a lot of kids in those poverty schools. Okay. Another one that we have is school lunches. We get about $12 million, $13 million a year in school lunches, and that's to feed the kids at the school. Now, we also get a little bit of state money, but that's the money directly associated with feeding kids inside the school system, and you get back money in relation to the number of students that we submit to the state. The other big one that we get is special education. We have about 6,500 to 7,000 kids on special education, and everybody hears it as IDEA. Has anybody ever heard that term? Okay, that's special education. That's how we get money for our special education students. We get about $16 million, not including what we spend in the general fund, but that's just federal money alone. We also get some money that's state money, because David talked about the state school fund money. There is a portion of the state school fund money also goes to special education and state grants. This is the money that's only directly related to federal. So you'll get a little bit in state money, and then you get federal money. And the other part is Head Start, which is our pre-K schools. We have about 8 sites, and that is the federal portion of what we give for the Head Start programs that we have. Now, you all excited about money? So if I think about 60-some million dollars in federal money, 4 of them encompassed in those big areas. So it's a really big amount of money in those grants. Other funding. Now, we spend other money that most people, and the biggest dollars that you see is called the student body funds. And that's the autonomy of the individual bank accounts that the principals have at the school. And that's where the money comes from, parent donations. That may be to buy the athletic equipment, or it may be there's a PTA or the foundation that wants to give about $500 to buy some uniforms for the volleyball team. Those are the monies that are the autonomy of the schools. Each one of the schools, and there's about 80 sites, they have their own individual bank account. It's managed by the schools, but at the end of the year, we bring it into the district, but they manage it and they get their private donations, or they may get a little mini grant, let's say, that's less than $5,000 that's going to enhance it, and they can buy laptops at the school. We get a lot of those. Those are managed through the student body funds that gives the principal a little bit of autonomy. They still have to follow the guidelines of the district, but they get to do a little bit of things just for the schools. Okay? Another thing is state grants. State grants, we get things that are the PE expansion grant, the reading expansion grant. Those are the grants that we get for the state that kind of parallel off with the federal, but they have different distinctions. The teacher initiative for professional development. We have some of those grants in that such areas. Okay, in that little $3 million, there's about 75 to 80 different grants that make up that. Some of them, we've got about 60 of them that are just $5,000 a piece. So they take up a lot of time. The school funding raise for staff. Basically, fundraising, as we think about fundraising in relation to all hands raised. You know, everybody heard of all hands raised. Some people have heard about as the foundation. Have they ever heard about those? Okay, Those are the parent raised that are basically you buy back what we couldn't afford in the general fund or the, what we call the state school fund. A lot of people do that, raising those funds to buy those positions back so they can do something in the general fund that typically nobody can and we can't do in the general fund because we don't have the funding for it. Does that make sense? Okay. School equity grants. All hands raised. We all raise our hands. Okay. No, didn't laugh on that one. Okay. All hands raised. A portion of the all hands raised go to equity grants. So as the law, we changed it several years ago, the first $10,000 go to the schools, right? So if a parent donates money, right off the bat, all the school gets the first $10,000. After the first $10,000, the two-thirds stays, goes back to the school, and then the one-third go back and make equity grants for those individual schools that are designated as the program, and a lot of them have to do and get the money because they may be a Title I school or they may be a priority zone school. They get those monies back in an equity grant, okay? And they're usually only last a year, so they have to spend those money. And then the other funds that we get pretty much are like the Mount Hood Cable. We get a lot of technology grants from Mount Hood Cable, and we've gotten a lot in the last couple of years, but most of that money is the Mount Hood Cable money that we have. And I think, David, I think you're back on.
Can I ask a question?
Yes.
Sorry, just since it's up. Now, you mentioned I was a little confused, because the student body funds, I thought you had mentioned foundations and that, but it looks like the green is specifically the school foundations.
Mm-hmm. Yes, it is.
So the PTA and everything is on the red bar, and the foundation specifically on the green bar?
Right. The PTAs, when you want to buy staff, basically a teacher to go back into the classroom.
That has to go in the fund.
That has to go in what we call the foundation or what we call the FTE buyback that goes to that. The money that goes in the $12 million, those are for non-FTE related functions. Okay? It's not related to the FTE. They can buy extended hours. They can buy some overtime. They can buy some professional development. A lot of the PTAs and the private foundations that they call themselves, there's about 9 of them in the district, they get the ability to donate money, and they donate it just to buy things like supplies and uniforms and stuff like that. That's what the $12 million. If you're buying staff, that's part of the $2.7 million.
Of that $12 million, how much of it is fees?
Student fees. I don't know the answer to that one right off the top of my head. I get your name and I can try to get you back that information because I don't know that information off the top of my head. I'm sorry. I know a lot of that, but not that one. I apologize.
So you've heard some about where the money comes from, and some of that is tied to how we use the money. In the general fund, which is where the bulk of our budget is, this is a breakout of how we use the money. 56% of the money goes for teachers and textbooks, so it's directly in the classroom. 20% of the money goes to other school staff and support for students and teachers. Another 15% goes for buses, transportation, buildings, so custodians and maintenance, and utilities. So you can see 91% of our money goes on those three broad categories. 4% is on central administration, 1% on debt and capital payments, and 4% is held in contingency, and contingencies are reserved for unforeseen circumstances. So it's a breakout on how we use the money. And finally, a couple of things about how we distribute staff to schools, because that's one of the things that we always get questions about. You could see from that previous slide that teachers and textbooks and support staff is the biggest part of our budget. And certainly on an individual school level, staff is the biggest amount of money that we spend in schools. So how do we decide how much staff to give to which schools? There's a number of factors that play into the staffing allocation for a school. The biggest factor is how many students are in the school. So when we allocate staff to the school each year, The largest component of that staffing allocation is a ratio based on number of students. So if the ratio was 20 to 1 and you have 500 students, you're going to get 25 FTE allocated to that school. Straight allocation based on number of students. Second component is based on the number of underserved students. That's what we call our equity formula. 8% of the staffing allocation to schools is driven through two equity formulas. Half of it is based on the number of students in the school who are on free and reduced price meals. The other half is a more complicated formula about historically underserved students that takes into account the number of students on free reduced meals, the number of students on special education programs, the number of students who are emerging bilingual learners, and students in one of four historically underserved racial groups. Third component for school allocation is based on, it's what we call our school-wide support table, and that's based on the school size or the grade configuration. So that's the formula through which we allocate a principal, maybe an assistant principal or a vice principal, counselors, secretaries, and other sort of school office support positions. We have a little bit of staffing that we use to mitigate certain unique circumstances. So if a school has more than one campus, they might get additional staffing for that. We have a little bit of staffing that we allocate based on specific special programs or program status. And then finally, we fund kindergarten separately. So we allocate teachers for kindergarten with a slightly more favorable ratio than the overall staffing ratio, because we decided several years ago that getting kids off to a good start in kindergarten was an important priority. You heard Cherie talk about three other factors that influence school staffing: federal funds, the grants, and parent-led fundraising. And finally, I'll give you an example of how that plays out across the board for schools. So we're using an example here of K-8 schools, so the same configuration of schools. And we picked four schools: Chavez, Creston, Hayhurst, and Laurelhurst. You can see that their enrollment varies anywhere from 343 students at Creston to 656 students at Laurelhurst. The percentage of students who are underserved using the criteria I mentioned earlier varies from 25 to 92%. So the level of poverty and need in those schools varies significantly. And you can see underneath that, there's the total amount of FTE allocated to each of those schools based on all of those factors I described earlier. And then that translates into a staff to student ratio that varies anywhere from 16.5 to 1 to 20 to 1 and per student funding numbers beneath that. And part of the reason we wanted to share those examples with you is that one of the questions we get often is about parent fundraising, and you heard Cherie talk about foundation money and PTAs and stuff like that. That money is factored into these calculations, and interestingly enough, in this particular case, the most affluent school in terms of parents is the one on the right, where the benefit of fundraising is more than offset by Title I and some of the other funding adjustments that we've put in place. So it's an example of how funding is different school by school, based not only on number of students, but also on our sense of perceived need and our attempt to allocate resources accordingly. The one thing I should have said before I started talking through this slide is the starting point for any of these discussions is that none of our schools are staffed at an adequate level. Based on one of the earlier slides you saw about funding levels, we're not saying that we have enough staff anywhere. And in any of our schools, you can make a very strong case for how there are additional things that we could and would like to do. But we do make an intentional effort in how we allocate resources to schools. Rita. So the question was, is the staff to student ratio a range or a number? So in this particular slide, it's a calculated number based on, you know, the actual allocation to these schools and the number of students. If your question has to do with what I mentioned earlier, that the first part of the staffing equation is a staffing ratio, which we use to calculate the initial allocation to those schools, that is a set number, but it's different for K-5, K-8, middle schools, and high schools. But for each of the high schools, it's a set number. For each of the middle schools, it's a set number. K-8, K-5, likewise. Right, because what happens on top of that is the equity formula varies on a school-by-school basis based on number of students. The school-wide support table, where you allocate a principal to each school, if all we did was just allocate a principal, then obviously one principal to a school of 700, one principal to a school of 350 is going to skew that staff to student ratio. Now, we do have a stair step of how we allocate that school-wide support, but it's not, it has steps in it. So you could have a school with 100 students more than another school, where that school-wide support allocation is the same, and that's going to drive down or up the relative staff-to-student ratio. And then you have the question of whether a school gets Title I money, which they use for additional staffing, and so on and so forth. So there's multiple factors that go into any one particular school and drive those numbers.
So to think about it, when you think about that, if there is any funding associated with an FTE, regardless of whether it's state school funding or not, that money, the FTE allocation, is driven by the additional funding sources. So the little asterisk says, if you have Title I money, and you have state school fund money, you have priority and zone money, and you have foundation equity money, those get to add up to the more dollars that you have. So that helps that school where you see the poverty that's 92 and 75 versus the 25 and the 27. Those numbers really do help because they get it because of they are high poverty, they get more funding. So there, even though the ratios of the FTE, does that make more sense?
Other questions? Yes, sir.
How often does the funding formula change by the state? Is that year by year, or is that pretty stable?
How often does the funding formula change? So the state will publish, I'll give you an illustration. Let's talk about next year, 2015-16. In the next few weeks, the state will publish their first estimate of the funding formula for next year. They will update that a couple of times before next year begins. They will update it numerous times during the course of next fiscal year. And they will finally settle the funding formula allocation for next year in March or April of the year following the end of the school year. I'm not making that up. I promise you that's actually the case. Now, it doesn't change, you know, if our state school fund grant is $350 million, it doesn't go from, you know, it doesn't fluctuate between 270 and 460 over that almost 2-year period, but it will move by millions of dollars during that time period. And the reason for that is not because the state are masochists, but, although they could be, but that's not why they do this. The reason that is the case is that the formula is, well, there's at least two reasons I can think of. The first reason is one of the primary components of funding that formula is local property tax collections. And so when they publish their first estimate shortly, that includes an aggregate forecast of what those local property tax collections will be in 197 school districts across the state. Then we don't know what those actual property tax levied are until October, November of this year, and we don't know what's actually collected until the year unfolds, because although We get about 91% of our property tax calculation, property tax collections in November, December, and January. There's still, you know, a tail that comes in. So they aggregate all of that, and that's one big piece of what's in the pot. The second big thing that's challenging is that the funding formula is based on the ADM number that you saw. And the what we get is based on our ADM relative to the total of the states. And that ADM is average daily membership. So you don't actually know what the final membership number is until the end of the school year. And so until the whole school year is played out, you don't know what the numerator for yourself or the denominator for the whole state is. And so that's part of the revision. It makes it challenging because you're forecasting and then you wait to see how that unfolds. But it is one of the glorious realities of school finance that you don't actually get final confirmation of your most significant funding number until about 9 months after the school year has ended.
As a supplement to that, does the actual structure of the formula itself change very often? I mean, I understand the amounts can change based on your inputs, but...
No, the structure of the formula doesn't change very often. There is a group of people who are looking at the funding formula right now. We actually have somebody in the room who is on the statewide task force looking at that. But at this, you know, the formula that we have in place right now hasn't changed, the formula hasn't changed significantly. So our experience of some of the elements of that changes from year to year. So for example, there is a factor built into the formula that's based on teacher experience. Each district's teacher experience relative to the state's teacher experience. And those numbers change. There are some carve-outs from the big pot to pay for specific things, like high-cost disability, small schools, and things like that. And those numbers change a little bit. The primary formula has stayed in place for a long time. And it's very highly correlated with, you know, the number of students you have as that plays out in average daily membership. But, you know, for us, when you're talking about a total amount of money that's, you know, between $300 and $400 million, a little fluctuation, you know, 0.5% is between $1.5 and $2 million, which is a lot of money in my personal checking account, but in the context of our district's budget is actually a relatively small fluctuation. Other questions? And there's no limit on the number of questions that any one person can ask until you start asking really foolish questions, and then there is a limit. So,
well, I was a little interested in how the funding formula maybe correlates to, I understand the funding formula is there partially as an equity sharing, you know, among school districts, but are there factors in there that kind of dictate if certain areas, for instance, can buy or build buildings cheaper or maintain them cheaper, or is that part of the formula also, or does, for instance, Portland get penalized maybe for being a high-cost area in these types of formulas?
So, in effect, Portland, you know, it doesn't take into account the cost of living. So there's nothing in there that factors in the cost of living. In fact, part of what drives the equalization is that if you are in a district like we are with a high property tax base, we have the best property tax base of anywhere in the state because we have downtown Portland. Because of that, so I mentioned that when I showed you the state school fund, about half of our money in the state school formula is property tax and half is the grant. In that fund, it's about 2/3 grant money and 1/3 property taxes. So when I tell you that, you can see that for us, we're actually out of kilter. We're, in some respects, subsidizing the rest of the state, as are other large sort of property tax districts. The funding formula is all about operations. It's not about building schools. There's no money that comes in that fund for building schools. It's all about, you know, day-to-day operations.
So when you think about the state school funding, it has the starting, where you start out, and there's like six different components, and then you get at the final number. It takes in like poverty adjustment, ESL adjustment, it takes in a special education adjustment, okay, teen parent adjustments, and then it takes in for urban or what small school districts, teacher, and then you'll get at the end.
Teacher experience.
And then the final one, then there's teacher experience. When you start
transportation.
Here, you may start at 50,000, you may end up with 53,000 at the end, because depending on where your students, as we do enrollment throughout, now we don't have to have the final enrollment until like November. When he says, when you look at them, we even start the year and we can't finish the enrollment until like November. So when he says you have 9 months before you end up, because most school districts in the state don't even get their enrollment in until the middle of November. So we don't have a final number, and you may change how they are and how we do the enrollment. That means how the shift of how you get your fund. Does it shift? Yes. You get a preliminary number, and then you have to figure out where your numbers end up at the end of the year. But that's basically, you start here and you end up with all the adjustments in the middle. And then at the final, you get that number. And as people in the state, of, as you said, 197, 194, those school districts do their enrollment, your number may go up and down based on how you did your numbers and what you end up at the end of the day. And it can go almost 48 months in the, they'll make adjustments almost 2 years, it can, after you've started your academic year.
Are you asking whether we get additional funding because Portland is more expensive than other places? Is that part of the question?
I just noticed the 15% buses and buildings and more, and I have to imagine that 15%, which is a reasonable amount of percent, would differ depending on geographic.
It really doesn't. We get funded at 70% of the cost of our transportation. So just because Portland is more expensive than other areas, we're doing additional funding for that. In that effect, you can say it's a penalty because we should get more funding, but we don't.
But transportation is a different cost factor for different districts. So in rural Oregon, where it's a, you know, where everything is a million miles from anywhere, relative to their number of students, they have high transportation expenses. They may have a really low cost of living, and you know, a teacher may be able to buy a house for half what they can buy in Portland. But we don't get any extra funding because it's an expensive place to live, and neither does anybody else in the metro area. Yes, ma'am.
I'm just curious, and forgive the question because I haven't lived in the U.S. for a long time, but does this system and the formula, is it similar to states nearby? I mean, is it... Okay.
I just moved here from Arizona, so I know how we're working in Arizona and other states. The equity model is almost consistent across the United States. The late 80s, beginning of the 90s, a lot of states switched, and they created formulas where they shifted the funding from the local taxpayer to the state. In Arizona, they call it the equalization formula. It's very similar concept, and it's if you go all over the United States, it's very similar in most of the states. It's a formula driven. The formula itself varies depending on which state you go to. Some give more weights to certain categories than others, but there is a formula almost in every state.
The only thing I'd add to that is that how states get their money varies from state to state. So Oregon is more dependent. So states have income tax, they have sales tax, they have property tax. The state of Oregon is more dependent on one revenue source than any other state in the country, and that dependency is on income tax. And that is a more volatile revenue source than sales tax or property tax. So the disadvantage we have as a state, Yusuf's absolutely right, lots of states have funding formulas that do some of the things that ours does. Our disadvantage as a state is that because we are so dependent on the income tax, there is a greater volatility. If we hit a recession, then we are more vulnerable to a revenue crunch than a state that has property tax and sales tax as a larger portion of their revenue.
The other thing I want to add to that is there is a unique system in Oregon, in effect, that just because you're a growing district does not necessarily mean you're going to get more money. In other states, that's probably true. If you grow, you will be receiving more funding. In Arizona, it depends on what the legislatures appropriate to the education field, to the K-12 education. That's a big factor in what we get. So we could be growing a number of kids and not receive any additional funding if the rest of the state grow at the same rate we do. So if we are at 8% of the total population of the kids, and next year we're still 8%, even though we have grown 10,000 kids, we will not receive additional funding. So there's that kind of variation that exists. This is, in effect, I see it very unique to Oregon. I haven't seen a system like this in other states. Typically in other states, if you're growing, you will receive funding because it's based on the number of students and it's prescribed per kid or per student, a certain amount of money that you get on an annual basis. Then there's a split between taxpayer, the local property taxes, and the state funding. So that's some of the differences, which makes it more challenging for us to kind of really project and budget. It makes it a lot harder.
I think I heard you correctly when you said building new schools is not covered by any of this. I mean, with Portland, we might be projected for a growth phase. How is that going to be funded, and does that affect our budget if we do have to build schools? Or
we typically go to the local taxpayers and ask for bonds. That's how we build our schools.
So right here, in 2012, voters in Portland passed a capital bond, first one for quite some time, and you think that Portland School District bonds is the tax collection to repay the first bonds issued under the 2012 voter authorization.
And that's part of what's going to the high schools
now. Right, that first authorization was to fund the modernization of three high schools, the rebuilding of one K-8 school, summer improvement work at a total of about 63 schools, and the repayment of about $45 million of debt that we had taken on to do some school roofs, to do some water utility some boiler burner upgrades, and to pay for Rosa Parks School, which is the only school built in this district in 25 or 30 years.
Yes.
So, to get back to your graph, we have a shortage. This information is great. Do you guys have some advice for us about how to move forward at trying to influence the state to correct this problem? Are there some kind of ways that you see might be better, have time spent better on than others?
Yes. John Isaac over there is our director of community involvement in public affairs, and I think I know what our answer to that is. As voters, you have a state representative and a state senator, and we would encourage parents and voters and taxpayers in Portland Public Schools to encourage their state legislators to fund schools at the level that they need to. So one of the big decisions that's out there right now, I mentioned the state school fund, right? One third of the money is aggregate property taxes. The two thirds is the amount of money that the legislature decides to appropriate for K-12 education every 2 years. The legislature is in session now, and they are considering how much money to appropriate. School districts across the state have a consensus number of $7.5 billion as the amount of money school districts need for next year to do the same things that they're doing this year. And what the school community has asked for is that the legislature fund K-12 education at no less than $7.875 billion, because that will allow us across the state to do what we're doing this year, next year, and to start reinvesting to start overcoming, I'm pointing down there, to start overcoming this trend as well. So what individuals can do is you can communicate with your state legislators, state legislators, and ask them to fund K-12 education at no less than $7.875 billion in the next biennium.
So I want to just, there is an opportunity to do this year. So the school board, and I think we have one school board member here, Bobby Regan, but she just left. The school board is sponsoring a PPS parent and family lobby day for the first time in a long time, where they're going to fund a bus to take parents down to lobby the legislature on Friday, April 5th. So if you're interested or anyone else is interested, contact the board office, Roseanne Powell, and reserve a spot on the bus. We're going to have room for 50 parents on the bus on April 5th. Okay?
I'll talk to Roseanne on Tuesday.
All right. There you go.
Yes.
As long as we're on this subject, can you mention the QEM funding?
Yes, I can.
Absence thereof.
So the QEM is the quality education model. And I don't remember when, but some considerable time ago, the legislature appointed a commission of people, the Quality Education Commission, and one of the things they asked them to do is to assess how much money would it take to meet the aspiration of all of our kids being where they needed to be. And they came up with a number. They looked at model schools, they looked at staffing ratios and things like that. And I don't remember off the top of my head how much the number is, but I will tell you that 7.875 is what it would take to get us from where we are now to where we need to be to meet the QEM. It's the first 2 years of a 10-year glide path. So the QEM amount is, it's like $9 billion. So we don't reasonably expect that the legislature is going to go from where we are today, boom, to QEM in one fell swoop. But part of the lobbying, part of the campaign, is to get us on that trajectory to get to that level. Roger.
I was just going to add that the PTA, the Oregon School Boards Association, OEA, and COSA, and I think there are some other organizations, are also organizing a lobby day in Salem on March 23rd, I believe it is. And we're going to hit the legislature double whammy hard.
Great.
Thank you.
Thank you, Roger. So any other questions?
Just a tiny bit.
Yeah, security and safety, do I assume that that's in and more on buses, buildings, and more? Or
yes.
Yes.
Is there, you wouldn't have,
off the top of my head?
No.
No. See me afterwards. See me afterwards. Okay. Anything else?
Yes.
Yes, ma'am.
Basically, the students' education. On this paper, it makes it seem as if each school is almost getting the same amount of money coming into their schools. So is it just that the schools are able to allocate them into different places once the money comes into their schools? Why the schools look so different, why the kids are getting a wide variety of different things? I mean, I've seen from school to school, there's certain schools that have better quality as far as education-wise, as far as just the instruction delivery is different. And so, and just a lot of the resources and support that they have within those schools and stuff. So, how do you explain that if you're showing me that it's only a little bit of money difference between each school? How could that there be so much disparities between the schools?
So, your question is how do things end up looking different from school to school? And part of that is how a decision's made about what happens at each particular school. So what I described here is how do we allocate the resources to the school? And part of the answer to your question is, then what happens? And what happens is the choices about how those resources are used at the school are made at the school. So by and large, that staffing allocation is not prescriptive. It's not that you have to have this teacher, that teacher, one of these, one of those, one of the other thing. So those choices are made on a school-by-school basis. Some of the money that you heard Cherie talk about, the Title I money, the school meals money, and those particular grants, those are for very specific purposes and have to be used in the way that the grant said. But the primary staffing allocation, there is discretion at the school site for how that money is used. There's also a variation in resources, whether it's volunteers, whether it's partners, and who else is engaged in support of what happens at the school. So there is a variation from school to school in how that plays out.
Okay, so I guess because you guys are saying that you guys need more funding, from my experience being in the buildings and stuff and seeing the differences and stuff, a lot of the problem could be PPS is not evaluating some of the things that are going on from building to building to maybe change some of those things to get better outcomes with the money that you're already getting. So does anybody do that as far as making sure the money's being spent wisely and effectively for the outcomes that you guys are looking for without actually needing more money?
So, yes.
Antonio Lopez, Assistant Superintendent for the Office of School Performance. So schools get different funds. You have your general allocation. Then they have like a special ed that is allocation on staffing depending on the number of students that are on a special education, IEP plans, instructional educational plans. Also, they get some money for ESL. I mean, they get some FTE for ESL. In terms of the ESL allocation in the SPED allocation, special education, those are pretty prescriptive. In terms of, these are the number of teachers, this is the number of paraeducators depending on the student's IEP. But in terms of the general funds, school have some discretion in terms of how they use it.
So for each school, is there a way that parents can get information about how the money's being spent, exactly what it's being allocated for within the different buildings and stuff? Who would be in charge of that?
Comparing
from school to school?
We can give you the allocations by school in terms of the allocation is in terms of positions. In terms of positions, teacher positions,
not,
so instructional ed assistants.
Building allocations, what I was saying, as far as what they decide specifically to spend the money on. Like if you have the Title I money.
Right.
To have it broke down, what was that spent on, is what I'm saying.
Like yeah, the school should be able, the principal should be able to share that with you. On the state of the schools, that it happens usually in September or when they invite the parents, principals should go over their budgets and how it's allocated.
So on the average, in their general fund that we call state school funding or how we give to the schools, on the average about 97% of it is FTE. About 3% of it is what we call consolidated money. That money is bought to buy copiers, other little small pencils and pens and whatever. Then the federal money that they get, that's Title I, they're very specific in their use because it has to be on their spending plan, which means I want to focus on math. I have to focus on this. They're very restrictive in their allocation of their funds because of that way. So you may get a school that looks like you got $6,000, but the money that they have for Cesar Chavez is very restrictive in the funding that they have to do because it's priority or a Title I school. So they have a focus plan that they have to work on. So that's the thing that they would talk about. And very of the non-personnel is very limited in each one of the schools.
So then the other schools that are not Title I, they would be able to spend it in other ways, then is basically what you're saying.
But when you think about it, universally across the entire district of all our schools, on the average, most schools don't get more than, on the average, 3 to 3.5% at the most. I've been here almost 10 years. About 3.5% is all they get for non-personnel. And that is required to spend on the copier, the pencils, the paper, the everything that you're taking to run that school that you're thinking about. The rest of it is supply, the rest of it is FTE. So there's not a lot of discretion that you think in that general fund number. The discretion that they have that's adding that number up higher is because of the federal and the state grants that they get or the arts tax money, and those all come with, believe me, a lot more restrictions than you get with the state school fund. They're very restrictive. They're required, like the arts tax, you have to do it specifically with this funding. If you're the Title I, you have to do this. If you're a gear up school, you can only do these things. But they're by those allocations, that's why those schools look like they have more money. They do. But the funding they get is everything is restricted. So when you think about the state school fund money, those monies that have discretion are only about 3 to 3.5 at the most at any one given school.
And also varies by school in depending on the number of students. The more students you have, the more resources or FTE or positions that are allocated to you. So size matters to get more resources.
That's the biggest factor. I'm going to say the size thing is a huge factor when you look at when people are looking at the K-8s with really small middle grades where it's really limited programming. You look at the size up there of just the examples that they've put up there, and you look at that admin staff and the number of staff available, also will reflect what kind of offerings are there in a school. So you can really feel like a very small middle grades in a K-8 that has really a small number of teachers teaching a whole lot of stuff, as opposed to a K-8 that's got a more robust number of kids in the 6th, 7th, and 8th grade where you can see a whole lot more program offering. I mean, that's a bunch of where the variability is, as well as the grants and the foundations and all the, you know, all the what other funds a particular school has to work with.
Or K-8s in the middle grade 6, 7, 8, and then comparing to a middle school that has 350
close.
Versus 120, things like that.
I heard part of a question. Please. What kind of oversight is there at the district level over how the spending is made? And the response I heard was...
Antonio was going to come answer that one.
Yeah, I don't know if I heard a response to the question.
You didn't hear that one yet. Yeah.
So that's what we do. The senior directors, after principals complete their staffing, the senior directors go over to make sure that the allocations are correctly made, that ESL teachers are used for ESL, the special ed teachers are used for special ed, and in the general funding that you're meeting the core instruction. So senior directors, which are the principal supervisors, they're signed on that saying, yeah, this is meeting the expectations.
And
then there is an audit. There is an audit that goes out every year.
So what you're speaking to is headcount and the allocation of relative allocation of for different functions, different offerings, right? Is that what I'm hearing?
What we do is we look at the school size, and from there we'll determine the FTE that is allocated based on that number. ESL look in terms of how many students qualify for special education, and ESL will determine also the number of students that are for ESL, and then we get all of that together, and that's the allocation that the schools get.
There's also guidance that gets put out at the beginning that is, here's the core program for different grade levels, and what you need to staff that at each of the grade levels. And as we're going through the staffing process, then as a principal, you've got to ensure that you've met the core program offerings before you have discretion to offer other things. And so part of what gets audited each year is we have a couple people who go through and go school by school to make sure that each school is meeting the minimum program requirements. So that's the other thing. We have some limited program evaluation that our research and evaluation department does, but it's more tied to when we're doing a particular project or a grant, and we're looking to it. That's one of the functions that's been cut during the years that we've been so drastically cutting that we're looking to build back, where we're able to do more specific program evaluation in terms of, so we track metrics
quality. Yeah, in terms of quality. We track metrics, like are we getting the outcomes we're looking for, but in terms of really qualitative program evaluation, it's tied much more to when we're doing an elaborate grant, where we, part of the grant is to have a program evaluation function. Or like our contracted alternative ed programs, we contract with an evaluator every year to look at those, so.
So just to give you more idea in terms of we have been meeting with the schools in terms of talking to the administration to find out how effective in terms of the allocations that they have made or the decisions that they have made, how effective are we getting kids to read in third grade, by third grade. You know, what the discipline looks like, and in high schools, how are we getting close to high school graduation? How many kids are on track for graduation? So there are some things that we're doing, how to make sure that how the resources are allocated, are they making a difference?
What is being done about evaluating those to making sure that all the grants are being followed, all the programs are being implemented into the schools properly and stuff like that? How do you guys evaluate that? And like even with our community partnerships and stuff, how do you guys evaluate and where does the money come for those? Is that through outside agencies or is it through some of these, the funding sources that you were talking about earlier? How do you guys allocate those and how do you prove them to be effective or whether you continue them, whether you drop them? How does that work?
If it was a federal or state or other, we apply for the money based on whether the allocation. What we try to have is each one of the grants have a program manager that oversees them, let's say a funded program, and then they report to one of the senior leadership who they basically decide how that is to be done. Some of the grants have research and evaluation written into the application. Let's say Gear Up, we have a Gear Up grant. They do research and evaluation. It's part of the money that we actually applied for at the time we got it. And then they go back and analyze, did we meet our goals? What were the objectives? And they go out to all the schools that they have designated in the grant, and they talk to the people, being the principals, the program people, the staff are there. It's part of the goals and objection. I give you the little funky FF-424 form, but it's some of the forms that we have to do as the agency every year or every 6 months back to the federal agency or in state agency. Have we met the guidelines? Now, they have to meet with senior leadership to evaluate that. They also meet with me and my staff, because there's four grant accountants, to make sure fiscally they've done what they needed to do with the funds that they've initially applied for. Now, does that change at any one given time? Yes, it does. Somebody may say, I started this school and we made the decision to close the school. Then we go back to the feds and say, can we reallocate those money or we change the initiative to what we're doing? As we've gotten a new superintendent, we had an old superintendent who had a philosophy about a grant. We went back and reorganized it and said, this is what we're going to do. But as leadership, they decide those things. And as we program managers, we assign them. The grant accountants are responsible to oversee the spending to ensure it's in compliance with the federal guidelines or the state application that we've applied for. So the federal and state guidelines are, there's a little bit more oversight because it's required by law and the compliance guidelines. The state and the state school fund money apply to the things that are associated with the plans that we're putting out by leadership and the oversight that we've now made in the superintendent and Tony have done in leadership to go out to the schools and do other oversight. And I also visit the schools to see how they're doing on their spending. So there are oversight, but I'm not a curriculum side, fiscal side. I look at their fiscal side and see if they're doing things fiscally in line to what we had planned to do in the initial budgets. So there is some oversight in relation to that.
So there are also a number of things where we're a partner that's part of a larger system, like our Sun Schools, where we actually put in dollars to have Sun School sites. as do the city and the county. And as all the partners we've identified here, the things we're measuring together. But we have dollars in as part of that. And then every year as a SUN system, we report on the outcomes that we've identified. Similarly, we have the Right Brain Initiative, which is an arts partnership in some of our schools that will identify what are the outcomes we're measuring, and we do that within the partnership. Or community-based organizations that are partnered with a specific school where we're identified at the front end, here are the things we believe we're working on with you, that is the deliverable as part of the partnership that we then measure and report and look at as we're renewing contracts. But because we have partnership contracts with a number of community-based organizations that Lorenzo's office, so the Office of School Partnerships, goes through and does the evaluation. The other thing, Antonio's department, so the senior directors, they have data that they are collecting on regular monthly visits with each one of their principals. So like when we're naming a third grade reading initiative or reducing our exclusionary discipline as an initiative, they're doing school by school, looking at each school's data with that principal on a regular basis. So there's that kind of an oversight that is what Antonio's department is doing.
I guess that's why I'm bringing forth these questions about the oversight and stuff, because there's quite a few situations that I've been in where I see that there needs to be some oversight, because I've been witness to things that are taking place within the schools and stuff. And so that's what I'm saying. Like, as a parent, if we don't know what a program is supposed to be looking like or what the contract says, because a lot of our schools already have contracts on like family engagement and stuff like that, but that's not happening. A lot of our schools are still empty. They don't have those relationships built and stuff. And so if you guys are paying money or organizations to do that, and they're not fulfilling their contracts and stuff, to me that's a waste of money. You know what I'm saying? And so that's why I'm asking, like, where is the oversight on how you guys are spending the money and how you guys are having your contracts if the contracts are not being fulfilled, unless that's no longer part of the contracts?
Individual situations bring forward so we understand, because we may or may not have that contract in a particular school. Like, it'd be worthwhile to bring a concern
and
forward.
And that's what I was going to say. Let's you and I talk if there are situations that where you want us to be aware.
Okay.
In a specific school, if it is a community-based organizations or our own people also, then I'll be more than happy to sit down with you.
Okay.
That's what I,
I think we have a question.
I have a question. I'm sorry, I arrived late, so I'm sorry if this was covered or if it's beyond the scope.
If it's already been covered, it'd be easy to answer, so that's
okay.
Fine.
And it may be beyond the scope of this because it seems like it's primarily focused on funding. But I understand this is more just generally about budget, so I'm going to ask the questions up here. And that is there an evaluation, what percentage of the overall district budget ends up in the school itself in the form of teachers and FTEs and just the school budget versus the administrative budget? And can you show me historical data on the trends in that? Is that available to be able to look at relative to the pie?
Sure.
How that's changed.
So just quickly to review,
I'm sorry.
How do we use the money? No problem. We have like I said, if we've already covered it, it's much easier to answer than if it's something that we haven't covered at all. So 56% teachers, textbooks right there in the classroom, 20% other school staff and support directly in schools, 15% buses, buildings, so maintenance, custodians and things like that, 4% central administration, 1% debt service and payments like that, and 4% in contingency. So 91% of our money is really close to schools. Those percentages have not changed appreciably over time. Over the last 8 or 9 years, certainly. I'm just talking about how far back I've looked. I think the percentages are have been pretty robust over time.
Sorry?
possible. It's possible.
I think that, if I remember correctly, the teacher and textbooks, I don't recall which year, probably last year or the year before, it was about 53%. So it got increased by at least 3% over the last couple of years. So which means we put more resources in the classroom in terms of teachers and textbooks and other resources.
It's hard to hear you when you use the mic.
Yeah, sorry for that.
What I was saying is over the last couple of years, I believe we have increased the resources in the classroom by at least 3%. We can verify and double check my numbers, but that's my recollection.
Okay, we're scheduled to end at 7:30, so Roger, I think you had your hand up. You may have the privilege. Oh, Rita, I beg your pardon.
Percentage.
Yes.
Has that remained stable over the last 20 years?
I don't know back 20 years, but over the last 11 years, it's been around 4%. And just so you know, these categories. The state of Oregon has a what they call a database initiative, which is their definition of these specific categories, and so we follow that. We take our budget categories and divide them up according to these. And I remember back in 2003 that we were talking about Portland Public Schools having about 4% of the budget on central administration. So I think it's been at or around 4% for the last 11 or 12 years, if my memory serves me correctly.
Okay, I'm going to ask you, you're not going to know the answer to this, but I'm going to ask it anyway. For years and years, I've heard that PPS slashed capacity, administrative capacity, during all the budget cuts.
Mm-hmm.
All kinds of things that used to be done can no longer be done.
Mm-hmm.
So things like evaluation.
Mm-hmm.
What would it take to build back that capacity? How big would the central administration have to be to have the kind of administrative capacity that PPS had in 1990?
As you said, I don't know the answer to that question, neither do any of us. What I would tell you, though, is if we were over the next 10 years to get to something like the quality education funding level, I don't know that these percentages would change dramatically, because at the same time as we would be rebuilding capacity in central office, to have an additional grant writer, to have additional evaluative capacity, and so on and so forth. We'd also be making sure we had a certified librarian in all of our elementary schools. We'd be adding back sports and athletics in middle grades. We'd be doing a whole bunch of things in schools as well. And so if we were increasing our overall budget from, if the funding from the state was going from 7.5 to 9.5, and a 30% increase, we'd probably be spending 80-something% of that 30% increase in schools at the same time as we were growing capacity centrally. So I don't know that the 4% would change dramatically, but at the same time as we were adding, PE teachers and matching the city arts income tax money with an equal amount of general fund money and getting librarians in those schools and, we'd also be rebuilding capacity in the central office, would be my guess.
The benchmarks of the other council, Great City Schools admin that we've compared to, I think is more like 8%.
Yes.
Admin.
Yeah, statewide, nationwide. Did you have numbers
on the share? So when you look at indirect over the last, when you look at indirect over the last 9 years, we've gone from about 4.3% this year, and last year's 5.87%, 6.5.
That's a different number, though.
So But it has part of the administration in it. But when you look at, as the Council of Great City School is part of administration, the biggest part of our indirect is administration, but a lot of it is outside contracts also. So the indirect that we have, or the administration that we have, is relatively small compared to other people in the state and as other people in the Council of Great City Schools in comparison across the country. So the administration that we have has been stayed relatively consistent over the years, and in relation to the Council of Great City Schools, which I believe she said 8%. So it is relatively consistent. You could add up all the things that add. If you added back research and evaluation over the years that we've picked up in grants and other things so we could do some of the things, we would have to figure out what that number is.
Let me share just one number quickly. Nationwide, if you look at education in general, when they define administration, they actually include the school administration and the central administration. So that's the number you're going to see if you look at data. That number is in the north of between 10 to 11% on average nationwide. For our district, that number is close to 8.5 to 9%. To kind of give you a range. But this particular formula, this is Oregon formula. You're not going to see this one in other states.
Can I add something? Yeah. Because I think you're getting at something that is... So I'm Erin Barnett, and I'm in the communications office, but I covered the schools starting with Measure 5 for the Oregonian. Obviously the proportions may not have changed, but I can tell you that the central office got smaller. I mean, I was in a department that was gutted. So we did lose people, right? I mean, we lost people, but the proportion may not have changed that much. But in some ways, the proportion at that point doesn't matter so much as do you have the people to do the work. And it actually would be fascinating to figure out what would it look like, what exactly would we add, because I can assure you that we spend pretty little time talking about what to add in the central office, because it's still about how to build back in the schools. And yes, we are doing some rebuilding in central, but clearly for the longest time, that was not a conversation at all. So that, I think, was even more of what you're getting at. And boy, I think it'd be kind of fun to look at a list of what if we really could have, the evaluators, the people we need to support our schools, yeah.
And as a potential advocate for increased state funding, it would make my job as an advocate a lot easier if I could say, you give us X more money and this is what we're going to do with it. We can do qualitative evaluation. We can do, blah, blah, blah. Otherwise, it's just giving money because I want money.
Thank you. That's really helpful.
Roger? I was just going to say, the school staff and support item includes a whole bunch of things, and maybe people ought to know that includes counselors and librarians and things like that, and it's not just a school secretary kind of so.
Yeah, I appreciate the clarification. Well, I want to thank all of you for coming tonight. I really appreciate it. Have a nice evening.